I am Professor Vivek Sathe of WIT Solapur. Now today we are going to discuss on fluid statics, and in session 1 we are going to discuss some basic concepts of fluid statics. Now before we start any session, we must know what are the learning outcomes. Learning outcomes are the measurable, say, parameters which we measure at the end of a session. And for me, when you complete this particular, say, video and go through it, you will be able to define what is static pressure. You will be able to derive the expression for static pressure, and you will be able to identify whether pressure is a scalar or vector. Now let us move. In mechanics, whether it is a fluid mechanics, whether it is applied mechanics, or whether it is any other kind of, say, pure mechanics, we study three varieties. One is called as statics, second is called kinematics, and third is called as dynamics. Out of this fluid statics, we are giving, say, first, say, treatment. And first of all, you know that fluid is a substance which consists of liquid as well as gas. Fluid is a substance in which liquid has got free surface and gas has got no free surface. So there is a different treatment for fluid and gas. We are restricting our discussion to the fluids, and that to liquids. Now liquid is a typical fluid which cannot sustain any shear stress. Means if I apply the shear force on the surface of a liquid, it will start moving in the laminar linear direction. So the fluid which does not exist, say, and contain the particular, say, shear stress is our prime importance. Now let us see. First of all, we must know how to measure the atmospheric pressure, because everything is related to atmospheric pressure that we are going to see in detail when we study the gauge pressure and the total pressure. Now the first important thing is, if I ask the students how to measure the atmospheric pressure, how to measure atmospheric pressure. The first question I ask to the students, what is the unit of pressure? Then many students answer it correctly, as they know that it is Newton per meter square. When it is Newton per meter square, the thing is clear, it is a force per unit area. But my question is, what is atmospheric pressure? So atmospheric pressure is the pressure which is exerted on a unit area on the surface of Earth by the air column which is present till the atmosphere exists. Now that pressure is approximately equal to 1 atmosphere, and that 1 atmosphere, if you do the calculations, it turns out to be 1.01325 bar, or it is, say, 10^5 Newton per meter square. Now the question is, how to measure this? If I ask, what is the device that we use for measuring the atmospheric pressure? Can you tell me? As we measure temperature with the help of a thermometer, with which device we measure the atmospheric pressure? Yes, it is the barometer. So barometer is a simple device which is used to measure the atmospheric pressure. Its construction is simple. Functioning is very, say, beautiful, and that will give the clear idea and feel that how atmospheric pressure acts on a particular surface. Now this particular, say, barometer was invented by Torricelli, and let us see how it is, say, measured. First of all, take a tube of approximately 1 meter length. Take a tube of approximately 1 meter length. Now why 1 meter? That I will tell you after some time. If you take 1 meter length, completely fill it with mercury. Completely fill it with mercury. Then put your thumb here. Then put your thumb on the top. Then take a bowl of mercury, which is completely filled, and let there be some space so that this particular mercury can be filled in this particular bowl. Now what you do? Now invert the particular tube and insert it into the mercury pot. Then as a logical, say, phenomena, you feel that all the mercury will come down and the entire level of the mercury will be slightly increased. Means generally, if I ask the students what will happen to the mercury, they say that if this is the tube in which it is inverted, mercury will come down and all the level will be same. But here is the difference that we observe in actual practice. So what happens when we invert the particular tube in the mercury bath or mercury, say, container, then mercury starts falling. You can see that in this particular portion where there was previously mercury, now what has happened? Because mercury is falling down, it is entering into this particular bowl, there is absolute vacuum. Actually, it is vacuum, but theoretically speaking, some mercury vapors at low pressure are present. But for all our practical calculations, we assume that the vapor pressure exerted by this mercury at this particular, say, it's a point A, is approximately zero. Then we know that why this happens then? So actually it is nothing but it is as if there is some membrane or a rubber membrane on this particular, and that rubber membrane has pushed that particular liquid, and this particular liquid layer is sustained by this force. So the pressure which is acting at this point, pressure which is acting at this point, is one and the same. So naturally, the pressure at this point B must also be same. So if I equate, say, pressure at A, pressure at C equal to pressure at B. Now what is pressure at C and pressure at B? I know that pressure at C is atmospheric pressure. Pressure at this point is also atmospheric. Pressure everywhere is atmospheric. But now suppose I take this tube whose cross-sectional area is A. Cross-sectional area is A. Then what is the volume of this part? It is A into H. This is my volume. What is the density of mercury? It is rho. And what is the weight of this mass? It is rho into A into H into G. So I will get this quantity as A H rho G. So this is the weight. So weight is nothing but force divided by area. So what I get? Rho G H. So rho G H is my pressure. So pressure up at this point is nothing but pressure at point A plus rho G H. So I will get, in simple terms, pressure at B is equal to pressure at A plus rho G H. Now one thing is clear from this: when pressure at A is zero, because I know that it is perfect vacuum, pressure at B is equal to rho G H. So this is, if you put the appropriate values of your, say, density of the mercury, gravitation, and the height that you measure, you will find that this column length is 76 centimeter. And that's why we say when the pressure is 1 atmosphere, it is 76 centimeter of mercury, or it is 760 millimeter of mercury, or if you want to call it as a 1 atmosphere, or we want to convert into bar, it is 1.01325 bar. So this is about the first important thing about a pressure. Now the question comes, in statics we talk about equilibrium. Now equilibrium is a very fundamental concept in mechanics. Suppose I have this particular, say, bench or a table on which I put some object. Now this object is having some weight, that is mg, and the surface is providing a normal reaction n. So in equilibrium, what I do, I equate this n to mg. So in equilibrium, for solid bodies, we equate forces. What we equate? Force. Now why we equate force for equilibrium for solids, and why we equate pressure for equilibrium for liquids, is the main thing that you must know. Now many students do not have idea that pressure, similarity of the pressure, or pressure is an important parameter for measuring the equivalence. Okay. Now see here, for solids, the surface is rough. So the actual area is less than apparent area. And the contact with the particular surface is such that, say, all area is not covered. So there is no point in assuming that pressure to be considered as force upon area. And that's why we take this as a force. In case of a liquid, the interface between this surface and this surface is approximately same, and the apparent area and actual area is one and the same. Therefore, for fluids, pressure is important parameter. So in fluid statics, we equate the pressure on the top and at the bottom. Now the next question that I want to ask you about this is whether pressure is a scalar or vector. Many students have the confusion and they say that pressure is a vector, because pressure is a defined as force upon area, and many people say that force is a vector quantity and area is a scalar quantity, so vector upon scalar becomes vector. Now about this we'll see in detail in the next session. Now before that, whatever the sketch I have drawn over here, you just have a thinking over it. This is a balloon in which liquid is filled, and there are small holes here, here, here I have made. Now suppose I put the piston down, what will happen? The water will ooze out from all the holes. Look at the directions in which the water is coming out. Is it normal to the surface or not? That is my question. So for today's session, we'll stop over here. Thank you. And for any reference, I advise you to refer the book by Fluid Mechanics by White, Fluid Mechanics by White by Tata McGraw-Hill Publication, TMH. Thank you.